Let us begin today as we begin all things in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
God of heaven and earth, you come in close and make us yours. Equip us by your Spirit to confess our sin, embrace your forgiveness, and see the way you set before us in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
With honesty of heart, let us confess our sin. Merciful Father, forgive us. Our will is made enough to sin that we cannot break free. We have spoken when we should have kept quiet. We were silent when we should have said something. We acted when we knew better. We were still when we knew we should have moved. For all we have done, the good we have failed to do, have mercy on us through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Son given to heal you and set you free because God loved the world so much. Take a hold of life, eternal life.
Amen.
Amen. Our gathering given today as saints of old, it's number 695 in your hymnal, and welcome to worship.
Oh, yes. chapter 7. After this I looked, and there was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, robed in white, with palm branches in their hands. They cried out in a loud voice, saying, "Salvation belongs to our God, who is seated on the throne, and to the Lamb." And all the angels stood around the throne, and around the elders, and the four living creatures. And they fell on their faces before the throne, and worshipped God, singing, "Amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, "Who are these robed in white? And where have they come from?" I said to him, "Sir, you are the one that knows." Then he said to me, "These are they who have come out of the great ordeal. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. For this reason they are before the throne of God and worship him day and night within his temple. And the one who is seated on the throne will shelter them. They will hunger no more and thirst no more. The sun will not strike them nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of the water of life. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us sing Psalm 34. Like him, for we will see him as he is. and all who have this hope in him purify themselves, just as he is pure. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
But more than that, a true time to that top, you could see all of Bradford in its lens. A quick snapshot all the way down to then the Hanover Hundred, the hospital, and Interstate Parkway, Gordon Street, and off to your left, Custer City, and Lewisburg. And to climb that mountain was a moment of pure kid nirvana. Or at least that's what I was told. See, I never made it to the top. The loose rocks, the cliff face, and of course my father's left hand stopped my progress when I would try to climb. Who knows? Maybe someday. Maybe someday I'll climb that mountain. It is no coincidence today that Matthew, in the beginning of the Sermon on the Mount, starts us like this. Jesus climbing the mountain to teach. From an acoustical sense, I guess, it would make sense that Jesus would climb up higher, to climb up so that all could hear and see him as he taught. But in this reading, we see Jesus journey up the mountain to deliver one of his greatest messages to us. And we see a parallel yet again, that of Moses' walk on earth, up the side of his mountain, Mount Sinai. Many times Matthew has drawn close parallels between Jesus and Moses. Jesus and Moses share many similarities if you look at their lives in contrast. Both were born under a threat of death from a ruler. They were both born under less than ideal conditions. Both were having to deal with Israel, the Jews, under the constant threat of an oppressive ruler. Both Jesus and Moses emerged out of Egypt and leaving Egypt to follow God's call to liberate his people. And like Moses, Jesus wandered in the wilderness and relies on God the Father to sustain him and to keep him safe. Both climbed the mountain, one to speak with God, to receive the commandments and deliver them to his chosen people, the Israelite nation. The other, Jesus, speaking to us as he is God, guiding those who follow him, revealing the comfort of the Father to a world weary under the strain of Roman rule. And a reminder to the leaders, the lepers, not only can, but shall and will be first, shall and will be made whole in the kingdom. Delivering the Father's message to the same people Moses had already addressed, only a few generations. In today's gospel, like Moses on Mount Sinai, Jesus interprets and delivers God's vision for the world based on God's expectations for actions happening within this world. In Jerusalem in the first century, or for us today in the here and now of the 21st century. In Moses' time, the Ten Commandments, God loves. In Jesus' time, revealing how God's creation and grace was for all. Delivering the gospel. These are not set to limit our scope of our vision to simply feed the hungry or care for the poor. It's not to limit our actions in life to choose to be hungry, poor, or treated poorly, but to extend our view to see God's call to service. As we too climb the mountain and recognize our own hunger, our own poverty, our own meekness and service, our own seeking justice as we walk within Jesus' call and in the Father's will revealed to us by the Spirit. Our walk will lead us to climb that mountain as well. We know our path will not always be easy. We remember that sometimes in our walk it is an uphill climb. Sometimes just the incline itself is daunting. Sometimes the world looks loose wrong. Sheer faces and steep ledges in our path as we continue to walk, and yet sometimes climb and crawl. We must climb and crawl our way through the world. The weight heavy, our steps steep. Yet Jesus reminds us today that even then we are blessed. Blessed. Praiseworthy. Heavenly bound. Recognized by the Father. And the poor as well as poor in spirit. the meek, the mourning, those who are hungry for justice and righteousness, those suffering persecution for righteousness, are now exalted by this preacher and teacher, Jesus, as he begins turning the world upside down, letting us know not to worry about it. God has us. And even if you are persecuted for his sake, by following him, Jesus said, your reward is great in heaven. So is today's reading a simple telling of how these things will be weighed, judged, in the final judgment only? Or is this a reminder Jesus is sending to those who follow in his steps that the journey is hard? You may find yourself poor in spirit as you follow the path Jesus has set us upon, but no worry, press on, for this is only temporary. Rejoice. For your reward, for your time, your journey is much greater than this, for yours is the kingdom of God. And yes, you may lose many things on this walk, jobs, family, or friends, and many things that you may still mourn the loss of, but never fear, you are not alone. There are others who, like you, are on this journey up the mountain, and they are there to be with you. Shy, meek, and seemingly lowly here on earth should rejoice, not because of only the rewards in heaven to come, but also because they will find that they too are not alone. That they are with you and I on this journey with them in companionship and love, and because of that, they will do great things, and in his name, for the world may take what it will from them. In the end, they will get all returned to them, and so much more. As they will inherit the earth. For those that long for righteousness, those who hunger and thirst for justice may be denied here on earth, but in the kingdom, in his name, their thirst and hunger will be no more. Those in this world who are judged because of their faith and walk with Jesus as weak, because of being merciful when there is none, being pure of heart where sin abounds, a peacemaker where war prevails, and those persecuted, jailed, exiled, and martyred for the sake of his call to us, all still sinners yet redeemed. These who prevail through the climb of Jesus up that holy mountain, our walk of faith. On that day, with Jesus the merciful, will receive mercy as they will see God and know God as being known as God's own, God's sons indeed. An inheritance of the King of Heaven. See, today's message not only to those as a reminder that the last, the least, the downcast, the downtrodden, those God sends us out in the world to help and to be in fellowship with, that these will be first, and that the first in this world will be last. Today is near to reminder of those times and path of faith the Spirit calls us. One that the Spirit calls us to is not easy, and that we are to prepare to climb God's holy mountain, and to keep climbing with each step, knowing that the journey will be one day easier, the load lighter. As we climb, remember to lean into his everlasting arms of comfort. As we climb, remember to listen to the Spirit's call to us to keep on keeping on, to help those who might have fallen or may be a hand fighting the path for which they somehow have strayed. And as we get closer to the top, we reach out to that hand reaching down to a scarred with nails, that hand which has our names carved into the palm of it, and a voice that tells us, turn back. Follow me, you know my voice. I am the good shepherd. As a child, I may never have reached the top of that mountain. The one on high street. But it's okay. See, that one will happen to me. See, today I'm on a climb up another mountain in this walk of faith. And I encourage you to come join me in that climb. Together we will race to the top. we carve our initials in that tree, put them with mine, and then we finally get there. I ask you, let us get started. I'll meet you out on the path. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Let us affirm our faith in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended to heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. And he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
Sterner, Greg Fisher, Ted's mother and Ted, Pam, Walter, Alex.
Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Holy Comforter, we pray for this congregation that the promise of your new life may be shared and experienced. We pray for the funeral ministry of this congregation that family and friends seeking your love find it here. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Holy One, for the saints who now rest in your mercy, we give you thanks. Remember their witness of faithfulness in love. Dave Graver. Doris Vega. Cynthia Soli. Senior.
Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great. Heavenly Father, we offer our spoken prayers and those that are held in our hearts, trusting in your mercy. We ask everything through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with all of you.
And also with you.
Let us offer each other a sign of peace.
Peace be with you.
Thank you. Christ doing for you.
Amen.
The blood of Christ shed for you.
Sending him today, ye watchers and ye holy ones, at summer 4:20.